Boom. Okay. So we're headed out on the road again, as we always do. And we're just going to try to do the best we can, as we always do. What else can we do is just make the effort and petition safe driving. Petition to Padma Buddha Lung Chempa Care now. Instant direct timeless support for perfectly safe traveling. Wow. Okay. Instant direct support for perfectly safe traveling. Yes, 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 yes. Very important that we dial this in and feel that this situation is going to go safely. So petitioning Padma Buddha Lung Chempa Care now. Instant direct timeless support for perfectly safe traveling. Wow. So you should feel kind of locked in to confidence that everything is going to go well on this trip. You've committed to it. No mishaps whatsoever. No mishaps. We should do that with our life trip too, our death trip. Really, it's a disruption trip. It's a disruption trip. This universe is actually a training program that we, Spirit, which is the extension of perfection, Spirit has designed a training program for itself to try and Wow. That's not nice. Holy cow. Wow, that BMW. Oh, gee, okay. That's okay. That was just a weird situation there. I was getting over, and the BMW was turning onto the road, and it decided just to just prevent me from getting over. There you go. So that's a disruption right there. So, and we're going today on this trip to continue to push, as the great mental health melt, the great mental health meltdown is happening now. It's been triggered by the election. I know this is loud. The road noise is loud in this particular vehicle. Road noise is loud, so I got to speak up a little more. I know that. I hopefully will get off the freeway up here in a while, and surface streets, and then it'll not be quite as loud. This tends to get loud at higher speed. So this world is a training program. As we pivot back to this, clear theory, it's a training program we have designed so that we can voluntarily engage in what is called disruption, producing disruption data by our suffering. We call it suffering, but it's disruption. We're disrupting equanimity, supposedly. But it's not really equanimity we're disrupting. We're just choosing to experience disruption of variable degrees of disruption, you might say. Variable degrees of disruption. Variable degrees of resistance to destructivity. And then our disruption, as we're experiencing it, is actually producing data. And this data is actually being collected in a subtle way in this great pool of data. The data disruption pool. Oof, what was that? Oh, gosh. Okay. All right, it's already been pretty interesting. This data disruption pool. And from this huge data disruption pool, we believe we'll be able to calculate how to disrupt perfection. We believe we'll be able to calculate how to disrupt perfection. So what we're doing in these so-called lives, which is just variable resistance and destructivity, is we are contributing through our voluntary effort, contributing data to this disruption data pool. So it's a collective undertaking we're engaged in here. It's not just a singular undertaking. We are volunteering for a collective undertaking where we all pool our data, okay, into one big pool, and then we are also working on subtly calculating from that pool how to disrupt perfection, and that takes place in various ways, subconscious ways, and also in the afterlife, you might say. There's a point where we see if we can disrupt perfection, and we cannot, so we then volunteer for another life. We say, the calculations are not yet sufficient. How much data do we need to locate what doesn't exist? A non-existent flaw in perfection. We're trying to disrupt perfection because we believe it has some power to conceal a flaw in perfection that we insist is there. It's not there. There's no flaw at all in perfection. This is a collective group effort that's taking place. Billions and billions and billions and billions, maybe even trillions of aspects of spirit are collaborating in this collective effort to produce enough data of disruption data that we can then come up with a model of how to best attack perfection and get past its defenses, disrupt its ability to conceal a flaw in perfection. This is what's happening here. So this is why this is a way, way, way better explanation than we're used to hearing. And so this is what is shocking for people. And I've just been working on this relentlessly. And my whole life, I knew it was there, but nobody else even expects to hear this at all. They're used to the old explanations, you know, which are, I believe that this greatly improves upon the older explanations that we are used to. But we tend to reject, we have a familiarity bias that rejects anything that doesn't fit in with what we're used to, which makes it then exceedingly difficult to get traction with this. Here, but we have to get traction right now. We're in this great mental health meltdown. We need to know what in the world is actually going on here. I mean, there's just a whole bunch of stuff now that is going on. And it never stops here because we're all intensely volunteering to produce all this huge amounts of disruption data for the collective good, believing that when we disrupt perfection and locate this flaw in perfection and fix it, we'll all benefit from this. Everyone will benefit and have this glorious experiencing of being prior to glorious experiencing, which is perfection. Kind of, how can we have a glorious experiencing of being prior to glorious experiencing? This is a question that we need to state to ourselves. Goodness gracious. Did you hear that? Ay. So the guy was lane splitting and just hit this extremely loud motorcycle. Two motorcycle guys with a motorcycle club. Looked like a motorcycle club. Could have been Hell's Angels, I don't know. But they hit it hard. Like Pat went past me like that, hitting it. What does that mean? Or Well, that's a mental health issue, right? I mean, people are like revving their engines and sounding really mean. It happened on the strip where the road is wide. Two cool sharks stand, two cool cats stand, standing side by side. A fuel-injected Stingray and a 413 are revving up our engines and it sounds real mean. Rev it up, buddy, gonna shut you. Tack it up, buddy, gonna shut you down. So they're revving up their engines. It sounded real mean. This is this mental health meltdown that we're having. So we are petitioning, as we have been doing for decades, for help with this. Now, at least we're aware of what's going on. At least we have a clarification of what this universe really is. And we have techniques to extract ourselves from the false hope that there's a way to locate what doesn't exist. But what we're looking for is additional help at this point. And that's that additional help at this point would be an atmosphere or an ambience of flawless equanimity. An ambience of flawless equanimity. Because as that motorcycle, that I guess it was a Harley, because nothing could sound quite like that. That had to be a Harley. And he just gunned it as he went past me. I think he pushed their clutch in or something so it doesn't lurch forward. And then just, you know, give full throttle. And that was the most jarring I think I've ever heard. That was so jarring. Probably the meanest time ever. People are here for the purposes of experiencing extreme disruption. They're volunteering to experience extreme disruption. Now, it's not equanimity that's being disrupted. It's a sort of a facsimile or an idea of equanimity. It's not real equanimity. The idea of searching for what doesn't exist is, does not have equanimity to it. It's balance. It's sort of, what's being disrupted is the idea of balance, a balance between good and bad, between truth and lies, between, I mean, where's the balance point in perfection, which is always equally everywhere? How do you find it? Where's the balance point? How can you balance perfection with imperfection? Is there such a thing as imperfection, actually? Now, there's a search for it, but there isn't actually any imperfection. So the disruption is disrupting some sort of equilibrium, or balancing that we have. Health is kind of a balancing act between all sorts of stuff. So they're seeking disruption on a global scale. I don't know what that, wow. That was some heavy, that was really shocking, that motorcycle was extremely close to where I was, extremely like about 3 feet away, and just gunning it. They do that, of course, to let you know that they're there. But I think they go a little extra. Oh my goodness. Revving up our engines, and it sounds real mean. Yeah, it sounds real mean. Thank you. So we're looking to get additional help, help beyond what we've received already. At this point, I think it's appropriate at this point to get the next level of help. We've had quite a bit of help. I mean, we've had Ramana Maharshi, we had Sri 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 Anandamayi Ma, and then we had A Course in Miracles. Then we had Tibetan Buddhism, help from Tibetan Buddhism. And then we had the revelation of February 10th, 2021. And we've had some very, very, you know, substantial help. But now that this is mental health meltdown has been triggered, which is what I said would happen. I didn't know exactly what would trigger it. I said, we'll find out. Well, now we know. It was the election that triggered it. And it's basically given the people that have come here to really maximize disruption, mental health disruption, you might say. It's given them an excuse to do it. They came here to do it, but they didn't want to seem like they were crazy. So now they can say, oh, I'm doing it because this monster, you know, the worst thing that ever could ever possibly happen has happened. And therefore, I'm just absolutely falling apart. It has completely undone me, and I'm just I'm feeling just this extreme disruption. It's an excuse they're using. No, they came here to provide disruption data. Now, they feel that everybody should participate because it's a collective enterprise. It is. And they feel that if you don't participate, you have no right then to participate in the benefits of this. Well, there are no benefits of this. So basically, we're being asked to torture ourselves for no benefit whatsoever. And so we're absolutely free to decide to not torture ourselves. We're absolutely free to decide to not torture ourselves. It's entirely voluntary. This is the 2021 revelation that was given to me. It made it absolutely clear that we are all voluntarily torturing ourselves. It is never, ever, ever, ever imposed upon us. So even karma is voluntary. You might say there's karma because they're habits, so to speak. But that's also voluntary. Even though it may seem to be mandatory, it's not. It's not. Just like us being here is not mandatory. It's voluntary. Yes, 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 yes. One sentence settles it all. One sentence settles it all. So we're getting a slowdown here of unknown origin. Uh-oh. I was told to get over. Maybe that motorcycle said, get over. You want to turn off on this road. Don't get stuck in this. It looks like things are moving pretty slowly up here, but that's okay. I don't know why. Where's everybody going? Well, maybe they're doing what we're doing. Maybe everybody's taping. You think so? How about nobody? Whew. Boy, that... Interesting. Last time I drove with this vehicle, I was driving, also taping, and there was this motorcycle, group of motorcycles, huge group, like over 100 of them. Come to a stop. That is not good. Has to be an accident. So there's this motorcycle motif of a motorcycle gang of people who are just revved up, really revved up. Well, that was a foreshadowing of this mental health meltdown, the great mental health meltdown. MHM, mental health meltdown that is happening. These people are doing it on purpose. They've trained themselves to have meltdowns. And I'm saying, we're talking about potential for self-immolations now. They may go to that extent. I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, of course, the Tibetan Buddhists did that to protest the Chinese occupation of their homeland. But it wouldn't be surprising to me if this situation snowballs. It really would not. This has more potential to snowball into an avalanche than anything. And this is what I saw in my dream. I saw as this situation goes forward, goes down the river, that there were these avalanches that took place that seemed to be, you know, done purposefully. These avalanches that became very, very viciously destructive. Those would be like protest marches and you know, massive protest marches. I bet that this is going to happen. There could be self-immolations, people lighting themselves on fire, committing suicide that way, to protest, just to say, hey, you know, we want to bring a maximum disruption here. They're using it as an excuse. For those who do not want to participate in this disruption situation, it's like, no, we're not bothered at all by what's going on. I'm not bothered by it at all. They're using it as an excuse. I mean, they twist everything so it seems like, you know, as catastrophically horrible, such that, you know, we have to protest this. We have to act out. We have to have a mental health meltdown. They're causing this. And I'm like, not causing any mental health meltdown for me at all. At all. But all these protests and trying to convince us all that we should also be having a mental health meltdown. And if we're not, we're intrinsically evil. You know, this is what they're saying. If we're not having a mental health meltdown, we're intrinsically evil and deserve to be punished. So they're virtue signaling, but it's more than that. I mean, that's superficial. That's superficial. They're literally trying to generate, you know, as much data as possible right now into this collective data pool, of the disruption data pool, in hopes that this will be sufficient to... Oh, goodness gracious. Oh, my goodness. Oh, wow. Vehicles are not behaving well. Wow. Okay. Someone literally went on, and now they just merged back. They didn't exit. Oh, goodness. Literally went on to a shoulder there and just passed me on the shoulder. I'm going the same speed as everybody. They just went onto the shoulder of the freeway and just zoomed past. And then they cut back in just to gain, four car lengths or something. Oh, there you go. So these people are disturbed. You don't drive that way unless you're disturbed. I think this mental health meltdown is designed to psych us all out. Psych us down into participating in it. That happened back in 63 with the Kennedy assassination. That was a mental health meltdown that we had in the country, in the world. And then we then got swept up by the Beatles, which actually, although it seemed like medicine at the time, had severe side effects to it. Really bad side effects. Horrible side effects. It's like taking a drug that has side effects, you know, 5-10 years down the road, like amphetamines, which the Beatles used extensively. So we got caught up in really kind of an amphetamized euphoria there with the Beatles. And then in the 70s, you know, then the side effects start showing up really, really, really bad. So we don't want to get swept up by the mental health meltdown, nor do we want to get swept up in some drug-like euphoria. So flawless equanimity is not some emotionalized euphoria. It is not. It feels much too good to celebrate in an emotional way. It feels much too good for any sort of emotional euphoria to arise from it. That would be an extreme downgrade from it. An extreme downgrade, yeah. So this is important to hear this, that this feeling of flawless equanimity, this field of equanimity, in no way is similar to emotional euphoria, emotionalized experiencing, delight, euphoric joy, and all this kind of stuff. In no way, it's not the same. It's much too precious to have any sort of celebration, emotionalized celebration of it. That's like trading in, you know, gold for a pitcher of gold or something, you know. It's like, what? Fake representation or something. Don't celebrate with some cheap representation of it. Then you don't have, you don't actually experience the actual value of it. Okay, well, that was a slowdown for no apparent reason. Wow. I've had a number of vehicles. That vehicle just passed me on the right. What does that mean? Okay. Interesting. I'll have to parse that one out. Okay, I think I understand what it might be getting at. Maybe. Okay. So I take these things as like attention getters to, hey, pay attention to something. And it may have something to do with taping the right of the road. We're going to do this return trip here on surface streets. We're doing the freeway right now. We're going to get off the freeway here, and we're going to go on surface streets. And I can't even remember the name of the road that we're... Oh, I think I got it now. Yeah, okay. Yeah. And is it the golden hour of sunlight? Not quite. It's still 3:30. Well, yeah, it is. The golden hour, last hour of sunlight is the golden hour of sunlight. So we timed it perfectly here. We're going to get off the freeway and then do a taping here. And this is interesting to me. It really is. All right. Very nice. Okay, good, good, good. Vehicles ahead of me got off here. It's always, I like to see that. We got a purpose here. The standards there, okay. Woo! Yes, yes, yes. And we're just going to go straight towards the mountains here. Can I get over here? No parking at any time. Okay. No parking at any time. I mean, I need to pull into a parking shopping center or something, you know, to fix the camera here in some way. I can do this. Can we do this here? No. Okay. Not really. Car wash. Yeah. So we're headed towards the mountains. I'd like to give you a view of this, and I will. As we'll probably do a different video with this one. No stopping, no parking. They don't allow. Wow, nobody's... Okay. Somebody's parked there. I don't know, why can't we park here? Oh, there are some cars parked along here now. Okay. Let me see if I can get over here. Fire hydrant, don't want to park too close to a fire hydrant. They're gonna get me in trouble. Okay. Let's,